listeners, welcome to Idiotalk, an Apple podcast, or when the pod hits the pod app, it plays like a king what it says every ep when it goes on the cloud, and you'll hear the whole thing before you let your phone ring. There's no podcast that's better when you're tuned in tonight. So when you have headphones, you choose your own cast. And remember that Glenn's are the greatest of hosts, and if you listen too fast, then you'll miss all the jokes. But if you wait, it won't matter because it's in your downloads. How'd we do?
How does one listen too fast to something?
I don't know. I guess if you play this on 1.5 or double speed, which I know a lot of people do with podcasts, but I don't.
No, stop it.
People do. I mean, why do you think that option's on there?
I don't know, actually. That's a good point.
But honestly, if you do that with our podcast, I put you on probation from being a listener because our timing is very important to the things that we're saying, to the comedic vibe, as well as the serious vibe of the things we're saying. By the way, absolutely. I'm Walker Glenn.
And I'm Zach Glenn.
And we are brothers who are in our second season of our podcast where we discuss the music we're obsessed with. Season one was about Radiohead. Season two, we're talking about Fiona Apple. And let's see. We have covered her first two studio albums at this point, but there is a long hiatus in Fiona Apple's career between her second album, truncated title, Win the Pawn, and her third studio album, full title, Extraordinary Machine. This time she decided to make it a little easier on us, said, let them say the whole thing in one sitting, yeah? And
and she did some traveling.
She did a little. She picked up an accent like Madonna
or Johnny Depp.
Johnny Depp. Oh my God. Yeah, yeah. I love to play my guitar and
poorly.
I like to play my guitar and wear five pairs of sunglasses at once
and 57 bracelets, none of which managed to be cool.
Have you tried my cologne, Salvage? I don't know how it's pronounced. There was a point where
it's called Savage.
Yeah, it's called Savage, but with a U. Like,
oh,
salvage.
I thought you said salvage, like salvage, and then the bottom line says this career.
You beat me to it. Yeah, it would have been called that if he was being more naked about what he was trying to do at that point. But I can't look, Johnny Depp. Controversial figure, seemingly terrible guy, I would say at his peak, fine actor. I don't know that at any point I have ever looked at him and be like, I want to smell like that guy.
No, I agree.
Especially not current Johnny Depp.
No.
Just like cigarettes and fucking Pinot Grigio. Like, I don't. It's so crazy. I've watched a couple movies with him lately in the 90s.
What did you dub him? Did you say seemingly fine actor at his peak? Is that what you said?
I said seemingly terrible person, fine actor at his peak.
You wouldn't ever go great at his peak.
I meant fine as in like the positive word, like, oh, what a fine
actor. Yeah, no, I think I'm maybe beating you to your point anyway, so please continue.
I don't know that I ever would, at any point that I consider Johnny Depp one of the greats. I think he's...
No, not one of the greats, but great at acting. You can be great at acting. You can be great at playing basketball, but not one of the greats, you know?
I think he's great in that way of like, I don't know that like I ever... He's one of those actors where he's great at being entertaining as some version. Like, I don't really like lose him, I would say. And I don't know. I just rewatched What's Eating Gilbert Grape, and like, that's pretty early in his career, but there's like some pretty dodgy acting moments from Johnny Depp in that, I would say. But I also just watched Ed Wood again, and I would say that is a great performance.
Yes, but he's incredible in that movie.
But I don't think he's a very subtle actor. Even in Ed Wood, he's got a lot of like facial.
He plays it big,
and he plays it really big, which totally works for that movie.
Same with his other great role in Pirates of the Caribbean, Curse of the Black Pearl, which I just rewatched, and I think he's fantastic in.
Okay, is that movie hold up?
To me, it did. Yeah, he plays it pretty big, though. Like you were just saying, yeah, I wouldn't call him a great actor either, so I'm on board.
Did I tell you that for a while my Instagram was my Instagram algorithm was convinced that I wanted to see videos of Johnny Depp all day, every day? It was like such a rough time where it was like, it's so weird. I still don't know what video I like hearted that it was just like, okay, we know what this
guy
wants.
How long did this go on for?
For like a couple months. And I was just every single video of Johnny Depp, I'm just putting not interested, not interested. And they're kind of like, you don't got to lie to us. We know that you love Johnny.
A little bit of Jordan Peterson to spice things up, maybe?
Yeah, sure. Like, at least when I get weird right-wing political material, though, I'm like, okay, but this is connected to the fact that I like a bunch of political content.
Yeah.
So yeah. But I'm like, I like a bunch of movie content, and I get fed a lot of stuff from movie accounts, but I do not know what it was. But it wasn't even just like, it wasn't like Johnny Depp official. It was like all these Johnny Depp fan accounts of just like videos of him playing guitar, interviews of him being like, to me, the secret of acting is you've got to get really in the mind of this person, and you can have fun as well. I'm making up this impression on the spot.
That was so good. That was so good.
And at a certain point, Amber pooped on my bed. And
I remember when that trial was going on, our mom was texting me. She's just like, I just can't believe how strange he is. And I was like, Mom, he's an actor. He's acting. Like he's playing a part.
Yeah.
And I think she responded like, go fuck yourself or something like that.
Yeah, that sounds like our mom.
But you know what I'm saying? I don't know why people are so floored. Our mom aside, I'm not saying that she was like Team Johnny at all or anything like that. But I just think it was funny. Now I feel bad for throwing her out by name. But I do think it's just funny that people were like, who is this character? I'm like, he's a professional.
Right.
He's playing a part.
Should we say what the episode is about today?
Yes, please.
Okay. So I believe I started talking about it, and then we went all over the damn place. But this is Idiot Talk, and that's what we do. Emphasis on the talk.
Yeah.
So Fiona Apple, we've covered her first two studio albums, and there is a long hiatus in her career from 1999 to 2005. We go without a Fiona Apple album. Now, we've said Fiona has a somewhat limited discography for somebody who has a career as long as she has. There's five studio albums, and we're not in a hurry to be done with this season. So we thought we'd take a hiatus episode where we basically just caught up. As you can probably already tell, it's a bit of a loosey-goosey vibe on this one. Always a comedic vibe, but sometimes a looser comedic vibe.
And for our movie heads out there, 1999 to 2005, or two Matrix sequels.
Ooh. Wait, so the first Matrix came out in 99.
Yeah.
And then what sequel came out in 2005?
None, but they had had two sequels by the time 2005 came. The series had concluded by 2003, so.
I was going to say, I thought the first three were pretty close together.
Yeah.
I don't think I've seen either of the sequels since the theater.
Oh, okay.
I'm not that into them. One of my hot takes is I think The Matrix is really overrated.
Well, I get that. Sorry, go ahead. Keep continuing, though. So
we are going to cover... Walker, what's that word you just said? Cover. Could it possibly have multiple meanings? Yes, it can, because we are going to cover Fiona Apple's covers, not the covers of her albums, not the picture on there, songs that she has covered, Zach. And Fiona Apple, it turns out, has covered a lot of songs over her career. So what I did was I picked out the five that she had recorded and released up to the point in her career that we are at now. So we have two songs from the Pleasantville soundtrack that actually came out in between Tidal and Win the Pawn. And then we have three other songs that came out at some point during the hiatus between Win the Pawn and Extraordinary Machine. Now, as far as covering the hiatus, you know, I think we're going to have more to say about these covers than this inactive period of Fiona Apple's career that that it turns out was not completely inactive. She was still playing shows around LA and, you know, did these different covers and collaborations, but it was inactive in terms of releasing original studio material and touring.
Yeah.
And I think that some of the reasons that Fiona has cited for that is something that we'll get into more when we discuss Extraordinary Machine. What do you think, Zach?
No, I'd agree. I mean, I think that it's interesting because, you know, as covered in season one for the band Radiohead, you know, they had a declared hiatus from their 2003 album Hail to the Thief to In Rainbows. And I don't really know, like, for, you know, the Strokes or another band who had a declared hiatus, Weezer, you know, or whatnot. But it's interesting because it's, to me, it's like 6 years is a very long time to have been at the level that she was and is, you know. It turns out that 8 years, you know, will be a gap far in the future from 2012 to 2020. But this is the first time. And I just think the level of confidence in yourself as a songwriter, and, you know, a lot of that had to do with, you know, I'm sure the success that she had achieved and so forth, you know, to not necessarily have to be cranking albums out. And that's really cool and good for her. But I don't know. Have you kind of ruminated on that? That just, like, man, that is a, like, think about the amount of change in America, where I think her primary audience is based, you know, that took place over that amount of time. And just the confidence you have to have in yourself as an artist to be like, when the time is right and when I'm ready to present as I want to present, I will do so. And not being as worried about trends and technology and all. What do you think?
I think that you are keying in on something that is, again, I feel like every time we talk about Fiona Apple, like, making a public move in her career, it's something that is kind of treated with derision at the time that is now a much more in vogue way of thinking about things. Because I feel like what you just described is, it's certainly like, I mean, capitalism is always going to be a hustle culture, right? Mm-hmm. And no matter what business you're in, whether it's creative or not, like, there's always going to be an emphasis on productivity by somebody else's standards. And I don't think we've gotten away from that. But I do think we are now in a world where people can more ably say and be understood, I'm taking time off for mental health reasons, or because I'm, you know, just because I'm burned out, or because I'm not going to crank out shit that I'm not happy with. But I don't know. I feel like at this time, if Fiona Apple, like, officially went on hiatus in 2000,
yeah,
it's kind of after like 3 years of nonstop whirlwind of fame, scrutiny, and like a lot of bad press. So,
and 5 years of busting her ass in the studio.
Exactly.
Or so studio and on the road.
I wish I could say that it seemed like this hiatus came from, I mean, I'm sure it was like the right move for her personally, but I wish it didn't seem like it came from a place of burnout, is the impression I get. And it seemed like it had to get pretty bad before this hiatus was taken. And I think that a lot of people don't come back from this, but I feel like when we get Extraordinary Machine, I think that we're getting a more fully realized artistic vision with everything she does after this first hiatus.
Well,
as much as I adore these first two albums, and as much as I think they're her, I think that it's like, it's an artist more in control of what they're putting out there. Well, and even that, it will get into it when we talk about Extraordinary Machine. Even that, I would say, I would actually back up on that slightly, because there's still pushback on the music.
No, but I know what you mean. I mean, for sure. But I know, I feel like I understand what you mean, I should say, rather than I know. I do feel like it's a more mature presentation. You know, as usually can happen in the arc of a great artist, I would say, you know, no artist is perfect. I think the imperfections are what make great art and material, you know, so fun to scrutinize. And Fiona is absolutely a part of that. And I think, just to kind of go back to what you were setting me up for asking, you know, way back, I would just like to say, and we're not going to follow this perfectly necessarily, but this is sort of part one of the hiatus, because as we just talked about, it's 6 years. I would say, talking about the covers and maybe what went into it, that's not to say, listener, that there's going to be exhaustive coverage of every single interview she gave in that time, but if there is a particular Fiona significant event in the 6 years, we're, you know, we've already laid out what we're going to talk about, because there are some in terms of interviews and so forth. But yeah, I don't know, I just love the confidence, and I'm really excited to dive into these covers. If I sound distracted, I'm really excited to talk about Extraordinary Machine based on the trailer you just gave of your thoughts.
Yeah,
about it.
Absolutely. I mean, I'm really excited to talk about it too. I think there is a significant event that does relate to the hiatus, and you probably know about this, Zach, but I think we should probably address the Roseland Ballroom.
Okay.
Do you know about this?
Not by this name, no.
So this was a concert in February of 2000, and I look, it's impossible to like trace something like somebody taking 5 years off from touring and releasing new music to one specific event, but I do kind of identify this as the final straw in both, like, I feel like there's these things that have caused significant backlash, the first being the VMA speech, then the second kind of being treated as pretentious for the 90 word album title. Both things seem pretty silly to me when you list them out. These are not huge scandals.
This one seems more like shame, self-shame too, from this event rather than
this one I think was kind of like a biggie in terms of it causing big backlash. And what that was is, in February of 2000, there was a set at the Roseland Ballroom hampered by equipment issues. There was 3,000 audience members there, and Fiona Apple walked off the stage pretty early in the concert. I have like a really negative piece of press about it. I don't know if I should read that.
Yeah, please.
So first of all, you know, the New York Post is like famous for doing a lot of like bad puns, very, very trashy rag. This is written by Bill Hoffman on March 2nd of 2000. I just want to say right now, Bill Hoffman is not welcome on the Idiotalk podcast. And you will see why when I read the way he talks about Fiona Apple in this, but I do just think it's like, there's something about how snotty this article is that I find amusing, that kind of like places it in time, you know? So, first of all, Zach, maybe you can help me understand what the play on words here is in this headline. It's Fiona. What is F-I-E? What does that word even mean?
I don't know.
Okay, well, I'm going to look it up because they clearly are pretty pleased with themselves. So the word is pronounced fi, and it is used to express disgust or outrage. If people don't answer your first letter, fi on them. So, okay, fi on ya, Fiona.
I've never heard that before.
Yeah, so you're going to really dig into the thesaurus to come up with this really excellent burn on Fiona Apple. But so fans, the whole headline is fans.
Or fians.
Yeah, fians. Fions. Like, couldn't, I don't know. I feel like it's like rotten apples is right there. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, if you're going to like.
Fiona Apple became a real Eve and gave Adam a deceitful apple.
That's pretty good. Yeah. Or just like,
it's pretty
like
bad.
I know. I was just trying to. I was just trying to be in solidarity with you. What about? Oh wow, and Zach, I want to say this next to this article is some of the trending articles on New York Post today. One is, woman threatened to shoot Donald Trump and son Barron straight in the face.
Then a listing of all of Johnny Depp's band's next shows.
Yeah. What are they called? The Hollywood vampires. Oh my God. It's so embarrassing. Okay. So fans, fie on ya, Fiona. Singer irks Apple crowd with tantrum. Weird place to put Apple, too, in the headline.
What the fuck?
But okay. Oh, Zach, you're going to like this first line, okay? Rock fans took a bite out of Fiona Apple yesterday after the fiery singer cracked up on stage, pitching a foul-mouthed tantrum and storming out after just 45 minutes. The bizarre musical meltdown occurred at the Roseland Ballroom in Manhattan, where the waifish 22-year-old blonde, not blonde.
Strawberry, not a blonde. Yes. Strawberry blonde at times. But not relevant. Not relevant to the article.
No, or to nor is the size of her frame waifish. But I I'm sorry. I call bullshit on this. I have never, ever thought of Fiona Apple as a blonde at any point.
I have.
She's a brunette.
No, she's strawberry. She's a strawberry blonde in my mind.
She's a brunette. She has dark brown hair.
I mean, I think that her hair, as she's gotten older, has darkened. But in a lot of these early photos, to me, I would definitely describe Fiona Apple as strawberry blonde.
Look, maybe it was the 90s. Well, it was 2000. But it was the tail end. We were on the cusp of the millennia. Sure, she had some highlights. But would you describe her as a waifish 22-year-old blonde? Is that...
No, I mean, I would never...
You're saying that's how you think of Fiona Apple?
No, I wouldn't describe a waifish 22-year-old blonde as that. Let alone Fiona Apple.
So, Zach, you're saying on Idiotalk at Apple Podcasts that the top attributes of Fiona Apple, as far as you're concerned, are her blonde hair.
No.
I know. I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. I'm just so upset with Bill Hoffman for this coverage that I'm turning on you. And right. This is, we always take it out on the people we love. And I apologize for that.
Well, no. Hey, it's tough. I mean, it's when somebody agrees with Bill Hoffman on anything, I understand wanting to jump down their throat. that I kind of agree with his call and her hair color is I'd have a hard time if I were you.
Thank you. Okay, I appreciate that. Now, okay, listen to this. So the 22-year-old waifish
blonde. Listen to this, Zach.
Was playing to a crowd of 3,200 who paid $27.50 for a ticket.
Shut
now,
up.
Let's adjust that for inflation. $27.50.
That's like $80.
In 2000.
I'm going to go $45.
Let's see. We're on an inflation calculator. Okay, Zach, you were very close. It is $48.82 today.
Okay.
Now, that is an incredibly reasonable price for a Fiona Apple show. Now, this was before Ticketmaster held a full monopoly and, you know, was charging all. If she tours now, she could want her fans to be able to see her for $5 a ticket and have no control over it because they'll just add $900 of fees on there.
Also, 3,000, not a small venue, not a big venue either, though.
No. Yeah, that's true. That's true. Okay, so about 15 minutes into Tuesday night's show, Apple, looking angry and anxious, launched into a rambling monologue about how bad the sound was. This is a quote. "You know, I just wanted to do real well in New York, but fuck, I can't hear myself," she raged. Things got worse as she plopped down on stage, buried her face in her hands, and began to sob. Concertgoers claimed she told music critics who were scribbling furiously, "Fuck you, put your notebooks away." As the band launched into Carry On, a tune from her debut album title, she raised her arms and ordered the musicians to stop. "This song is dead. Just stop it. This is a nightmare." She told the puzzled crowd she was taking a 5-minute break and would be right back, but she returned 20 minutes later and would be right back. She never returned. 20 minutes later, a spokesman for Apple sheepishly told the restless audience to go home, but insisted the singer would do a makeup show and deliver her usual 110%. And then it just talks about that it quotes a bunch of fans in the chat room of her official website, which is one of the most 2000 things I've ever heard. I won't read every quote, but this is my favorite one. This is from a concert goer named Dralagon, who said, "She really went psychotic. She completely ruined what could have been a great show. And she didn't have to say the F word every other word." So, Zach, here's what I want to say. I almost feel it's one of these things that I feel a little funny about even covering this, because this is one of those things where, in response to like the negative press she got about the first couple things, those to me seem like real nothing burgers. And just like, we kind of can't wait to attack this outspoken young lady, basically, who we don't like, you know, kind of, it's all very shut up and dribble type of an attitude. Now with this one, I feel like whether or not we think that what Fiona Apple did was morally right or not, it does seem like a genuine kind of breakdown is like being experienced here. And so it's like a little bit of like a thing I feel a little bit funny about covering, but I also feel like it feels very informative to the long break that is taken here. Like this does seem like cracking under the pressure to me. Do you have thoughts about it? About like,
oh, I sure do. I just wanted to
what happened and talking about it. Like, what do you think?
I would just like to start off by saying that I don't want listeners to think, and I would just like to say, like, this podcast is not going to be an exercise in exonerating a flawed individual of every, you know, mistake perceived at the time or genuine mistake that they may have made.
Right.
That said, like, I think that this moment lives in both you know, things are events or behaviors are often many things all at the same time. I do think that it would be incorrect to label this as like a diva moment, but I think that with little information you could label it that, and I wouldn't be offended. I also think that I don't know, it's just like, I don't want to chalk it up to her age or maturity level or anything like that, because she's a seasoned performer at this point. But I just think that like there are examples of this throughout a lot of musical artists' career of kind of you know, getting frustrated, because it's like, we think of art, well, I shouldn't say we do, but I think a lot of us tend to think of art as this like transcendent sort of moment, right? Because they're with the prevalence of things like YouTube or whatever, you know, even before that, you know, great live albums or whatever, you hear it and you're just like, I'm in the moment with this person and with this crowd, you know, in this moment that may have happened in the 1970s or whatever, you know? But yeah, it's like, it's still an organized and methodical thing. And, you know, I mean, even in like meeting people is easy. There's that moment of Tom York, you know, getting very upset at the person on behind the scenes. I think it's at Letterman, you know, and it's not that I think that we hold performers up to this, oh, they're impervious to these diva moments. I think that we associate that to a lot of rock stars and movie stars and so forth. But I think when you see it playing out, it can be very kind of ugly and uncomfortable. I think seeing this one played out is not really that, because it's like, she's trying to do a good job. She's not losing it. She's not unraveling due to, you know, who knows, maybe she was on some sort of narcotics or anything like that, but she's not having a meltdown like Billie Joe Armstrong did at the iHeart, you know, Radio Awards, where
this is not like a Brown M&M's Van Halen moment.
No,
like, this
not
is,
at all.
This is
she's upset,
succumbing
with the
to the frustrations of technical difficulties.
Yes, and I think that, I don't know about you, man, but like, I think that there's a difference between this and the Christian Bale rant at the lighting gaffer, you know, on the set of Terminator Salvation. But I would say what they both have in common for me as I've gotten older is they are professional people that are tremendously talented artists. And I almost feel bad comparing the two, because Christian Bale was like endangering that person's safety. But with perspective and seeing the way that I have not acted out in any sort of similar regard, but like how frustrated I've become at my own job, where the stakes are much, much lower conceivably. There's at least less money on the line. And I'm not trying to say, listeners, I've ever, ever, ever melted down or yelled at some studio hand or something like that. But just how stressed out I've gotten out of my own job, you know, it just has a different resonance to me as I get older. And I do think there are times when people act like divas and jerks and abuse the level of power and status that they have. And the only way I'm equating it to the Christian Bale one is like, when that came out, everyone was like, fuck him, spoiled actor, spoiled brat. Meanwhile, it's like this person and the amount of pressure that is revolving around their ability to do their job in a timely fashion is huge, and more than you will ever feel, average person, probably, conceivably. And I don't know. I don't think those are the good best one-to-one, but I feel like you could maybe help me out to distill my point there. What do you think?
I think you're making it really well. I think you are perfectly... I think I was kind of not being very clear and trying to get you to tease out of me, like, the sure. complexities of this... of what we're covering here. And yeah, exactly. Like, it's just like, I'm really happy.
And Christian Bale has since gone on the record to apologize profusely. That's the only reason why I feel okay invoking that. Please go ahead.
Yeah. But like, I get it. It's like, we're not here to treat our subjects on this podcast as inhuman and therefore not susceptible to the same standards of behavior that us mere mm-hmm. mortals are. I do love that at this point in her career, the criticism against her has aged much more poorly than the thing mm-hmm. she was getting criticized for in terms yeah. of these other kind of backlash moments that we've covered. This is one where I think that it's context matters, and I think you supplied a good context there. And I totally understand that the fans who attended this concert were bummed, but I think there's a lot going on here that isn't, as you put it, isn't this person being a prima donna or a diva. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now, you know, Zach, what this reminds me of a little bit, you brought up Tom backstage at Letterman. This reminds me of a Tom moment that we have more of an up close and personal relationship to, which it reminds me a little bit of when we saw Tom play with his band The Smile at the Bill Graham Civic Auditorium on December 18th, 2022. And my man would not stop bitching about how cold it was.
Yeah, but he completed the show, though.
He did complete the show, but
put on a great show.
Yes, but you know what? If I was like this fan who had a problem with Fiona saying the F word every other word, yeah. what was the quote? Is we'll never fucking play this place again. And uh-huh. so I do understand, too, how it doesn't seem like Fiona was taking this out on her fans, but it's but it is a very uncomfortable sensation when you like just have so much adoration for a a prominent performer? Person. Yeah, a performer who, you know, like as fans, we tend to put up on some kind of pedestal. Sure. And and then you're seeing them be human. Yeah. That can be uncomfortable.
Well, and the line too, it's really cool to see him be a little bit human, but not too human. You know, these right. standards are so hard.
And once again, too, that word human is really key here because I remember that this incident came up in Fiona Apple's interview with Marc Maron. And, mm-hmm. yeah, you know, he's like, so that thing at the Roseland Ballroom, like, yeah, so what the fuck happened there, you know, or whatever.
That and, thing, Mark.
Yeah, exactly. So like, so your dad, he's some kind of like fucking actor or something? Or
yeah, my dad was a doctor. I don't know if you've ever heard me say that 700 times.
So I'm going to, if I could just ask you about your dad as a thin pretense to talk about mine for the next 45 minutes. Yeah, you know, it's like I was trying this fucking joke the other day, man. And I'm just like, what do you people want?
Yeah, did you ever get into that heroin? That black tar shit was really bad in the 80s.
Oh, when that stuff was going around, there's ghosts in that comedy store still, man, you know, because when I was there with Kinnison, shit got really dark.
That shit got dark.
I'm a huge fan of Marc Maron. Just really love.
Yeah, great interview, by the way, listeners, too.
Yeah, but yes, he does talk about his dad and Sam Kinison a lot. That these things are undeniable. So if you want to make fun of Marc Maron, that should be a part of your impression. But I don't remember how he framed the question, but I do remember her exact answer. His question is like something to the extent of what happened there. And she just, with no hesitation, goes, I'm a fucking human being. And mm-hmm. I think that that sums this mm-hmm. up pretty well. Now, I do think it is, to me, like kind of, like I said, it does feel kind of like the final quote unquote incident in this string, in the 3 years of her career that mm-hmm. we have covered so far. I feel like you can see these things. I can see a through line with all this negative press to just like, fuck it, I am mm-hmm. going underground. And the one thing I will also say about this hiatus is that she really did not know if she was going to return mm-hmm. to music. During this time.
I think of Fiona in three sort of, like, Fiona Apple's career, I think of it in like three sort of, like almost like the Giza Plateau, like three pyramids or something like that.
I know what that is.
And within those three, I see you could segment them out by two. So within this first pyramid is Tidal and Win the Pawn. And I see Win the Pawn as an extraordinarily strong second half where it's like it just starts at a higher peak, you know. But in terms of burnout, I really start to see this as like just like a crack in the armor, right? Where it's like you're really starting to see just like the weighing, you know, of the just the immense amount of you know you can relate it to your own when you're it's like when you can look back on the last month or whatever, you know, and you're like, man, you almost know when you're starting to burn out. But when you still have a little bit of gas left in the tank, and then when you're just out. Yeah. So it's just, and I love the way she answers that. I'm a fucking human being. It just is such a strong answer. Anyways, that's all. I really enjoyed that.
Yeah. I looked up the Giza Plateau while you were talking, because I didn't know this by name, but I've seen these. These are some pyramids. Listeners, I would also say too, for exhaustive coverage of Tom York's complaining about the alleged draft in the Bill Graham Civic Auditorium, go listen to our episode, The Smile Live. Uh-huh. I would say that, yes, he finished the show, but I also think, I believe that Fiona Apple was experiencing these sound issues, and I still maintain some skepticism over how cold the building actually was. So I would say maybe she was reacting poorly to a real problem, but he was reacting poorly to a fake problem. So I think that the fact that Tom York complaining about that draft was not as career defining of a moment as this was for Fiona Apple might be an example of some misogyny in the music industry. Still alive and well.
Sure.
Okay, but that ends here on Idiotalk. That is one of the goals of this season of the podcast, by the way, is to end misogyny in America.
And to learn how to spell it for me as well. It's a word constantly misspelled.
Dude, that's up there with, you know, okay, this is silly to say this word, but I will never spell diarrhea correctly the first three times. And also, when you spell diarrhea incorrectly in a text,
it's like, did you mean clock?
No, there's no autocorrect no replacements found, it always says.
Right, I know.
Okay, spell diarrhea right now for me, and I'll tell you how close you get.
Okay, D-I-A...
Hold on. Okay, go ahead.
D-I-A-R-E-H...
Wrong.
A?
Okay. Wrong.
Okay, well, I don't know.
You want to try one more time?
Sure. D-I-A-H-R-E-A.
Well, I want to say you were wrong both times, but with no judgment, because I feel vindicated, because this word is spelled crazy. It is D-I-A-R-R-H-E-A. Diarrhea.
Yeah.
Is there anything else you want to say about the Roseland Ballroom? Is there anything else you want to say about like the hiatus generally before we get into the covers?
No, not at all. I would like to just underscore and summarize my point earlier that I really admire the bravery of a 6-year gap, because I invoked the boys earlier, 4 years. 4 years is, you know, that's somebody's high school, that's somebody's college. You know, a lot can change in a person's life and around in society for that years. And I just really admire the bravery of that as an artist. I think it's really, really cool. And I understand it's a luxury. That's what I was trying to say. But a very if afforded that luxury as an artist, I think it's great that she was able to take advantage of it.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the time that she took off before Extraordinary Machine was time for me as like a fan to grow up enough to like be ready for Extraordinary Machine.
Yeah, we talked about that. That's so cool.
Yeah, and I don't know that she planned it with me in mind, but I don't know that she didn't either. Here's a question. This may get cut. Zach and I often joke about this. There's this great moment in Knocked Up where Seth Rogen's character is talking to Katherine Heigl about how she's interviewing Vince Vaughn. And he says, I feel like he'd like me. Mm-hmm. Right. And Zach and I often assess celebrities from that like metric of like, would they like me? And there are certain ones that I'm like very confident they would really like me. Do you think Fiona Apple would like us?
I do. I think that she would like how silly we are.
Oh, you didn't even have to think about it.
Well, yeah. I mean, I like Fiona, so.
I kind of feel like us being such huge fans might, I don't think it like gets us, I don't think it takes us out of the running of being, I think it's a ding against us, if anything.
Yeah, I think it's how you could, are able to compose yourself around somebody like that you have great admiration for is what allows to move the relationship forward where it's like they are willing to even have a conversation with you.
Do you think it would be like a thing where it's like we become friends with Fiona Apple and then like and then it's like, you know, like 6 months in that at some point you're just kind of casually like, yeah, you know, actually I did a podcast about you. Like, it's not just about you. We didn't want about radio until. Like, do you think, like, and can the friendship survive that?
Probably because she would never listen. So,
yeah. Or do you think she'd be like, I'm not mad that you did the podcast. I'm mad that you didn't tell
you
me.
Didn't
and
tell
I
me.
Feel like we become friends on false pretenses.
Yeah, exactly. I love like, that game so much, though, because it's not an automatic. It's not like a one-to-one of, oh, I like this person's work. I would want to be their friend. But, you know, or they would want to, they would like me. So don't go thinking that, listeners. It's not a one-for-one.
No, yeah, no, this is what I want to be her friend, but I'm not convinced that she would like me. Here's what I would do, because what I hate this concept of nagging, right? Because it's like the way to play the fandom is really tricky, because I don't want to come in just like, oh my God, you're like the voice of a generation. I love your songs. Right? Can't do that. No. But I also don't want to be like, oh, yeah, I listen to that little Idler wheel. You know, like, I don't want to, like, try to do some, like, bullshit, like, pickup artist shit, right? So what I would do is I'd go, I would, like, when we're becoming friends and she says, like, I'm like, oh, what do you do? And she says she's a musician. I'm super like, oh, my God, that's so cool. Mm-hmm. Wow, good for you. Like, I'm really, like, affirming of it.
Yeah, yeah.
But I pretend so much that I am not a fan that like I like oversell it. And like when I see a piano, I'm like, what is this? Like I like pretend like I like pick up a guitar and I go, is this some kind of like hammer or something? Like, do you use it? And I like start like knocking it into things. Like that's
well, I
what
I
would
stop
do.
Being friends with you. Right? Like, what is this fucking idiot's problem? No matter how smart you presented previously before that, I think that would be a turnoff for anybody, musician or non.
You don't think she might be like, oh my God,
how
what
cute.
A like, like no. What a unique perspective.
No. No, but I think though, I think that though for performers like Fiona, you know, and it's so hard because it's like I don't want to break oh, this type of person or anything like that, where I do believe that every person is unique, especially in the performer category. But you can't escape the reality that it's like, even if you have to segment out the fame that your talents have achieved or have brought to you, you do want some level of attention, even if that attention makes you feel really withdrawn or whatever.
Right.
So, but in my very, very limited experience, people that make great stuff, I think what they ultimately want is to be interacted with and treated as a person while not totally discounting their skills and achievements as an artist.
Totally.
So it's okay to kind of talk about those, but not, you know, and I'm not trying to make it sound like I rub elbows with famous people at all, but I'm just saying like that's sort of my experience. I don't know, generalized. What do you think?
I agree with that. Here's what I think about the chances of us becoming friends with Fiona Apple.
Oh,
I think that we, I, what's that?
So we're not dropping this.
No. This is really important. And I'd love the listeners to weigh in on if you think we could be friends with Fiona Apple. And which of us, then pit us against each other, which out of the two of us do you think is more likely to be able to make that friendship?
I think you are more likely.
Oh, see, I think, Zach, I was going to say, this is great because we both admire each other, because I was going to say, I think it's you.
Oh, thank you. That's so sweet of you.
Look, whatever That's one of really us sweet. Becomes friends with her first, it's like, hey,
let's
Fee.
Sell.
Yeah, first of all, it's like, hey, Fee, what's up? Like, by the way, like this whole hang thing that we have going, it's going so great. I got to tell you, I got this brother, and I think the two of you would really hit it off. He doesn't know what a piano is either. So you're not going to have to worry that you're just, you know, being fetishized for your musical ability. But what I was going to say is, I think that we are more likely to become friends with Fiona Apple than Tom York.
I agree.
I think she would take to
I
us
could
more
not
quickly.
Keep my shit together. And it's not, I mean, truly, it's not, Radiohead is my favorite band. Tom York is my favorite frontman. It's not, though, that like the amount that Radiohead surpasses Fiona Apple is substantial, really, at all. I could not keep my shit together.
Well, she's more
around.
Silly. I feel like that's
yeah,
the,
yeah.
She
I
likes
agree.
To be silly, and he doesn't really like to be that silly.
Well, I don't think I could keep my shit together around Johnny Greenwood, though, in a way that I think would make him super uncomfortable.
I think there's very little chance of not making any of the people that we're listening uncomfortable. I think it's very hard to interact with somebody that you think is like the coolest person. And I would be bringing that baggage to any of the people that we're listening, that we're listing. But here's, I think we are more likely to become friends with Fiona Apple than Tom York. First of all, she lives in the continental United States. So that's an advantage right there.
Totally. And, she likes cool weather a little more.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. She's not complaining about drafts and shit like that. So we
and
could,
he's from
you know,
England.
I know, dude. London fog. Hello.
June gloom.
But I do think that we are, out of all of the people in the Radiohead or Fiona camp, we are most likely and able to become friends with, say it with me, the handsome man Ed O'Brien.
I should have said it with you. I was just thinking, I feel like he would be a good hang. And he'd be like, yeah, he wouldn't mind if you tell him about his favorite parts too. They're his favorite contributions to Radiohead songs. He's like, what are you talking about today? Weird Fishes?
Totally. And I would totally throw him a bone and be like, I don't know. Like, I've always felt like the best part of Paranoid Android is like, just that part with the shaker at the end. And he's like, okay, you know, I actually did that. I'd be like, oh, did you? Like, I'd play it cool.
Or,
you know?
Yeah, be like, you know, I've always loved the part in Optimistic of the quietest guitar.
Yeah, that one that you could tell they wanted to mix out of the song completely, but it was almost as if somebody wouldn't let them. All right, well, Brian, the guy, once again, just to recap what we've covered so far, writer Bill Hoffman, banned from Idiotalk podcast for his slander and condescension to Fiona Apple. Fiona Apple, welcome.
Not banned.
We've got an open seat for you anytime you want to come on. And hey, if we manage to organically parlay that guest appearance into an off-air friendship, hell, I'll take an acquaintanceship. An acquaintanceship would be a huge upgrade from where we're at now. This first one that I pulled up is from the soundtrack of the movie Pleasantville. She has two songs on this soundtrack. This is a cover of the Beatles song from the album Let It Be by John Lennon, Across the Universe. Now, Zach, I want to ask you a question. Have you ever seen the movie Pleasantville?
I have. I've seen it. I'd seen it, you know, as a young adult, maybe, I don't know, probably around the time I was getting really into Fiona Apple, 2011, 2012.
How is it? I've never seen it.
And then I was going to say more recently during the pandemic, probably in 2020, I rewatched it. It's really ambitious and really cool. it's definitely in that era where it's like, oh, they, not they could do this so easily, but like the amount of work technologically that went into making it at the time was so extensive. And I do think it makes a difference in the viewing experience as opposed to now. I'm not saying it wouldn't be easy or it wouldn't require work, but it would be a lot swifter in terms of shooting it and creating it. Mm-hmm. And so I think it's kind of hard to appreciate the amount of work technologically that went into it. And I do think that the visual metaphor is, it's not that it's unsophisticated, but once you kind of get what's happening, it's a little bit like, huh, okay.
Sure.
So, you know what I'm saying?
I do. It's like a Leave It to Beaver world, right? That's in black and white. And when the characters experience real feeling, they turn to color. And shit kind of starts to unravel.
Yeah, particularly like, you know, intercourse or whatever, you know, anything sort of sexual, you know, definitely is more what it's weighted on. But also feelings. But I think, though, that, yeah, it's, I don't know. It's also one of those movies that's like, I feel like it's well cast, but like its casting is sort of distracting in a way. Like Tobey Maguire and Reese Witherspoon as the male and female lead make total sense, and I love Jeff Daniels in it, but Joan Allen and William H. Macy as a pair, two great actors, are a little bit distracting for some reason. I don't know why that is. That's
when
totally
I think
subjective.
Of it, I just think of on the preview of Joan Allen being in color and William H. Macy going, "It'll go away," and she says, "I don't want it to go away." You know, I was not allowed to see it, and I was like obsessed with seeing it. And mom and dad would not let me because they looked it up on screenit.com and found out that Joan Allen's character turns to color after she masturbates in a bathtub.
Yeah, and that might be why.
For me to not be allowed to see it.
Well, I think that may have been why the way
and
I
now
said too,
that
like,
I can, I don't care about it.
Oh, I'd say it's worth watching for sure.
Okay.
So she does some really interesting things timing-wise on her cover here.
Yeah, go into it. I notice it's slowed down.
It's slowed down, and on the intro when she starts off, we'll just have to listen to it for a minute. Basically, from the breaks of the verse to the chorus, she'll come in a beat earlier or a beat late, which I think is really neat.
Oh, yeah, sure. Should also say this is produced by John Bryan, friend of Fiona Apple.
The show.
Friend of the show. Friend of a friend of the show, for sure.
So I think we might get another one of those odd timing.
No, we're at the
Maybe
outro.
Yeah. And it's really cool. Did you want to talk about the music video maybe after the song concludes?
Talk about whatever you want.
Well, it's just such a cool thing because, you know, there's a shot, I think it's right as she's going into this, where it's like similar to how they shot 2001 of the rotating centrifuge, where it's very clear that what they did is they strapped Fiona Apple into some sort of rotating centrifuge for the camera. And the camera is rotating in tandem with her so that even once she's upside down, she appears right side up, but she's clearly upside down because her hair is standing up.
Yeah.
And that to me was really interesting because a lot of what they're doing is she's shot against probably a blue screen because what the characters in the music video are doing are essentially smashing up like a 50s diner. But if you think about the safety concern of that, like a lot of that broken glass could hit her in the eye. Like there's a lot of, so what I think they did is they probably shot a static Fiona against a blue screen and then added all this in, but it doesn't appear that way. It looks very interactive. And so just props to the filmmakers there. I think it's some fucking guy who, you know, didn't go anywhere, you know, made this music.
Yeah,
video,
it was nepotism. She got her boyfriend a job.
Yeah, exactly.
It's P.T. Anderson, right?
Yes, exactly. And it's so beautifully shot. Did you get a chance to watch it?
I watched it while I was doing shoulder presses in the gym today, and I set my phone in front of me and put the video on. And I was like, "It does it look weird that I'm watching a black and white video of Fiona Apple right now?" And then I thought, you know what? I don't give a shit if any of these people want to judge me. I'm working while I'm grinding, you know?
Exactly. Yeah.
You know, I love to get my grind on, and
absolutely.
And it's to have a little bit of Fiona on the soundtrack while I'm getting mm-hmm. in reps. Heaven.
Yeah, it's just really cool because it's like it's just one of those music videos that I think, you know, could tell a story. And we talked about this like with guest Casey Pegram, like the video for the song Daydreaming, for instance, just because music videos are not as much of a tool to like sell music with as they used to be, you know, because automatically it goes up on YouTube and just the model of the music industry. I do think it's really neat, you know, across the universe, just one of John's. What I find to be so interesting about this song in Beatles context is it does seem to be, even Paul McCartney on the Beatles anthology says, like, this is a John Lennon song. This isn't really a Beatles song. And Paul never quick to take away his own credit and contribution in Lennon McCartney songs. But he's like, this is a John song. And what I think is so interesting is, like, obviously there is the film made after it. Obviously there have been more than one, in my opinion, incredible covers of this song, Fiona Apple being one of them. But it was a really poorly recorded and mixed song. I think the original mixing and credit went to Phil Spector. It was just not a high quality recording, say in comparison to something like Strawberry Fields Forever or just, you know, other hallmarks of John's career. But anyways, all that to say, I just think that it's the music video has a story to it, and I'm not even sure what that narrative necessarily is, but it's really, really beautifully shot, and there's a lot of incorporation of technology, like I was just talking about with the blue screen. She's reacting to what is happening to her, but she's also not reacting to it in a way that's very cool, you know? A lot of chaos is happening. So I really, really, really enjoyed it.
Yeah, she has these big old-fashioned headphones on while a riot is basically taking place around her. It's a cool video. I love this song. Mm-hmm. I love her version of it. I think mm-hmm. that this song is so beautiful in its writing and composition that you can't really fuck it up unless you're Phil Spector, which he did. It's so great overloaded.
Producer. Yeah.
Yeah. But bad producer for, you know, I mean, but
Beatles music. Yeah.
Yeah, or certainly for what that project was, right? Which was supposed to be them doing stripped down live recording, and then he came in and just added his like wall of sound to everything on that.
So you
one,
think it's too busy on that one?
Yeah, because it's because do you know the Let It Be Naked version?
Yeah, I still find it to be pretty poor, but better though. So yeah, I really liked Let It Be Naked though. It was really ear opening.
Yeah, it really was. It really raised that album in my esteem of where it fits in with the Beatles records, because it's a really disconnected album. The songs are really disconnected from each other on the original mm-hmm. version, because it goes from these live rooftop performances to a John Lennon song with a children's choir like dubbed on top of it. And when they strip it all down, it sounds much more cohesive. In any case, mm-hmm. I really like the Let It Be Naked version. I really like this version. Zach laid a fucking absolutely nuclear take on me today and said that he likes Rufus Wainwright's version better than this. And I gotta say, I really thought that we were past you
talking off pod about myself. Stuff like,
please. But I mean, we spent on our first episode of this season or second episode, we talked all about how all conversations are content.
Right.
And then you text me hours before we're going to record an episode about Fiona Apple's covers with a hard opinion about this song that I could be reacting to now. We could be discussing now, but instead we're discussing how you breached etiquette.
No, but you said
I didn't even have the chance to tap the sign that says all conversations are content. Yeah, defend yourself.
Well, you just said it about Fiona Apple's cover, not Rufus Wainwright's cover. So I didn't even think that we were going to talk about it on pod. I thought it would just be like a fun aside.
You said Rufus Wainwright's cover is better than Fiona Apple's cover. That could have been an hour of idiot talk right there if you said that to me and I could react to it organically right now.
Listen, man, you're not wrong. I wasn't trying to betray the pact of all conversations or content, because in my mind it was like, oh, that's like a fun aside. I didn't think that you would want to spend time on the pod talking about an artist Well, I mean, that's even silly as I'm saying it out loud because we just were talking about the Beatles. But yeah, I mean, hey, man, you know, we all make mistakes. So
I know, but you make this one over and over again.
No, our second season. I have not.
And you keep telling me your takes off pod.
I have not made this mistake.
Bring
since
them to the pod.
I think OK Computer was the last instance of it being a frequently made mistake.
Okay, well, I'll tell you what then. I have a sign behind me, as you can see, that says, we have gone this many days without Zach bringing up content off pod. And before it said, if you can see right here, I had up since OK Computer, I think it's been, what did it say?
468
days. 468 days since Zach has brought, what does it say? I can't read it. It says Zach... It has been 468 days since Zach has brought up on pod topics off pod. I wasn't, my glasses weren't on before, but that's what it says. I am now, as you can see, I'm picking up the dry erase, the dry eraser, and I am erasing the 468 and I am putting zero. So, okay, we will chalk this up to a workplace accident. Shit happens, but I'm telling you what, man, one of us is going to lose a proverbial arm in the machine if you keep this up. We have safety regulations for a reason.
Yes, so duly noted. I would venture to say, though, did we want to listen to the Rufus Wainwright cover to compare, or do we want to roll past that?
I don't have it on the soundboard.
Oh, darn it. Okay,
but I listened to it after you said that.
Oh, okay.
And I like it too. I would say what both of these covers have in common is I don't think either of them are particularly necessary.
Sure.
Now there's like some sort
of conventional... It's hard to cover the Beatles though, man, and make it necessary.
It's exactly. It's just I don't have a problem. I think if you're going to cover the Beatles, do it live. That's like something where it's like that's really fun. But a recorded and released cover of a Beatles song, I don't know. They're not. What's the word I'm searching for? They're not malleable enough to be treated like standards. Mm-hmm. And we've heard them too many times to like detach from the original. Mm-hmm. I don't know. The Beatles are just too present. It's like I don't really want to hear those songs. Mm-hmm. Changed that much. I don't have anything against it as a rule. I really like this version of this song. I get why she would do it if she was commissioned to do it for this soundtrack. And I think that it's a really nice version. Her voice is very different than John Lennon, so I like it.
Yeah.
But both of them, I'm kind of like, would be fine without.
Well, you know, musically, existing. What I think... What she's doing that's so interesting, the way she's going, sounds of laughter, da, da, da. She's almost singing the harmony.
Yeah.
She's singing the harmony as the lead, which I think is a really bold choice because you kind of lose the melody. You don't lose the melody, but it's like when someone comes in with a guitar solo or something, like instead of doing like a strong lead line or doing the exact melody. But if you think of that as a guitar solo, do, da, do, da, do, da, do, da, it's almost like part two of a guitar harmony. Or so it's really, really neat. So yeah. I appreciated that a lot as a choice. I thought that was really, really cool.
I do too. I like it. This is apropos of nothing except that I have ADD and, well, undiagnosed. Mm-hmm. Maybe I shouldn't say that.
This you sound is like every single person in the world at Instagram right now.
Oh, yeah. Not my ADHD brain saying something because I thought of something because of something somebody else said. This is a thing only people with a diagnosed condition do. Oh my God, I was doing something and I forgot what I was doing and then remembered. I'm so weird. I'm so random. But you were reminding, have I ever told you that one of my favorite things in music is when the singer references a guitar and then the guitar does a little riff kind of like
did somebody
that's like getting ready for a solo. Like an example would be like, I pick up my guitar and play and won't get fooled again. And when he says that, Pete Townsend goes like,
What about in Foreigner when he's like, he had one guitar?
I hate that song so much. I hate Foreigner.
Foreigner is so bad.
I regard Foreigner the way Donald Trump regards foreigners.
Oh, right.
I don't want them.
But
I don't
like
want
that
them
era's Nickelback.
Yeah, I don't. Dude, good call. But no, yeah, do you know what I'm saying? Where it's like kind of like the singer references a guitar and then it does a little lick. And it's kind of, I like it because it's kind of like the guitar being like, did somebody say my name?
Uh-huh.
And the
call
other
and
example.
Response.
Yeah. The other example I can think of is an American Idiot in the Trey Cool sung section of Homecoming, I think.
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
When he's like, I play the shit out the drums, and I can play the guitar, and it goes. Anyway, should we move on to the next song?
Sure.
God, that was so ADHD of me. All right. This is Please Send Me Someone to Love from the same soundtrack from a movie I was not allowed to see and am still not allowed to see. And Mom and Dad, if you're listening, I have continued to not watch it out of deference. And obedience to you, because I keep because this boy keeps all 10 of the commandments and honor the father and mother right at the tip top, as far as I'm concerned. So if I am allowed to watch Pleasantville now, mummy, daddy, please let me know. And I would like
let's
to
move
see
on.
It. Zach has watched it with. Now, were you allowed to watch it, Zach, or did you just?
Yeah, I broke the 11th
leave
commandment.
Childish things. What's the 11th commandment?
Thou shalt not watch Pleasantville.
Yeah, that one's weirdly specific.
I know.
People make a lot of fun of the Old Testament God now, like insecure he is about like, don't worship that rock or whatever. Like he's
I'm a jealous God. It's like, what a bitch.
Yeah, exactly. I am an all-powerful
being. It's like you're
being.
God.
Yes, but I experience the petty emotion of jealousy. But also, but weirdly, even weirdly less talked about is that he was like, don't watch the 1998 movie Pleasantville, directed and written by Gary Ross. I hate Gary. Yes.
He was also a producer.
Now, but see, but when
along
Jesus,
with Steven Soderbergh.
Oh, that's a fun fact. Now, but when Jesus died for us and took on the sins of the world, did that? Is that when we are allowed to watch Pleasantville?
No,
are you
no,
like,
no.
A, you know, like adhering to like a Abrahamic kind
no,
of
no, this is a Seventh Day Adventist
are you?
Doctrine specifically, actually.
Okay,
go to church on Saturday. And don't watch Pleasantville. And I think when you said Jesus, you mean Willem Dafoe, right?
I do mean Willem Dafoe, the most Christ-like of all our actors. If Christ was, well, because like Christ, Willem Dafoe is hung. Listeners, if you don't mind seeing a penis, Google Willem Dafoe's, because my God. Little known fact about Willem Dafoe, he has a giant dick.
He and who's the douchebag in Casino? Sharon Stone's like ex-boyfriend, Lester.
Oh, James Woods?
James Woods has a huge penis, supposedly.
Well, it's right there in the name.
It's confirmed, yeah. What are we listening to right now?
We're listening to Please Send Me Someone to Love. This is by Percy Mayfield. Kind of a blues standard.
Mm-hmm.
I like this song. I don't know the original. I like
I really
Fiona's version
like
of
the
it.
Song.
Ooh, yeah. We got a little saucy.
Yeah. Oh, piano.
Yeah.
Oh,
now,
ivories.
Now, if I was listening to this in front of Fiona when that part came in, I would go, what is that? I don't know what that is.
Oh, ivories. That's just a little off the tongue.
Ooh, I like that. I like that.
Tickle
them. Those black and whites. I also call out like weirdly specific notes too, like let me hear a B flat.
Oh no, not that one.
Yeah, no, middle B flat.
You're picky. Oh, an octave higher.
Well, that was Please Send Me Someone to Love.
That was great.
Okay, jumping way ahead, jumping all the way into 2002. So what's going on in 2002? We're putting gauges in our ears. We're
Radiohead recording Hail to the Thief.
Radiohead are recording Hail to the Thief. We're still the shadow of 9/11.
San Francisco Giants are losing the World Series to the Anaheim Angels.
Oh, is that the World Series where you cried at the end of it at Marmar's house?
Yes.
Oh, I remember that.
Yeah, it was really very, very hard moment.
That was really sweet. Okay, so how old are
the Oakland Raiders lost the Super Bowl.
Okay.
Yeah.
And yeah.
Tough year for Bay Area sports fans.
And we're all mad at the Dixie Chicks and System of a Down for criticizing U.S. foreign policy in response to 9/11. Mm-hmm. And Fiona Apple is collaborating with Johnny Cash on one of his, I believe he made 5 albums with Rick Rubin altogether, maybe more, honestly.
Oh, really? Okay.
But this is American 4. And no, he probably made more because there's at least 5 of the American, and then he made a couple other that have.
I made at least 5 albums with Johnny Cash.
Yeah, Rick Rubin. A friend of mine was recently telling me to read his book, and I had to say, like, well, I did tell them, I was like, my brother just read it, which is
Rick
true,
Rubin's
right?
book.
Didn't you?
No, I read Bryan Cranston's book.
Okay. I thought you thought you were reading Rick Rubin's book for some reason.
No, I didn't even know you had a book.
In any case, I had to tell them, like, this is a very good and smart friend of mine who's like really into kind of like interesting, I would say a strong interest in meditation and kind of like, you know, expanding your mind through different like spiritual practices and things like that. So I could see the draw to Rick Rubin. We were connecting on a lot of different things, but I did have to kind of confess that there's something about Rick Rubin that I don't trust, is how I put it.
Yeah.
And I think we've talked about this before, is just like, I love a lot of his work, but I also am like not convinced that he's not a fraud.
Oh, totally. No, his beard is a web of secrets.
Yeah, that's right. And the secret is I don't actually know. I'm not actually producing these albums.
Like, my engineers are.
Yeah, and I don't know anything about music. I just think he's kind of a charlatan. But
he's made some of the greatest albums of the last.
I know. I don't really have decades. Good. It's just
no.
It's,
we've talked about it. Yeah.
Yeah. He just has the same approach for every single. I just.
What if for this one we stripped everything down?
Right. Exactly. Every single album now. With Johnny Cash, this was a huge career comeback for Johnny Cash in the early 2000s when he made these albums with Rick Rubin, which some of them have more full orchestration, but like most famously, the one everyone knows is his cover of Nine Inch Nails Hurt. And this was a point where Johnny Cash, very old guy at this point, warbling vocals, often just an acoustic guitar, maybe
popularity
a piano
was in the
playing
tank.
Bass notes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Huge comeback. And he would cover a lot of, they're mostly covers, and the covers would run the gamut from